When it comes to long wheelbase cruisers or even luxurious drop-top convertibles, Mercedes is really second to none when it comes to auto manufacturers. And a lot of the time when you do see your favorite cars in a movie or even a music video, it's tricky marketing or product placement, but Mercedes has kind of done it the long way. Today we're going to be talking about how Mercedes, through a host of innovations in passenger comfort and vehicle design, over the past century and even a little bit longer, has made themselves the ultimate manufacturer when it comes to passenger comfort and vehicle luxury. My name is Danny Kruger with FCP Euro. I'm the resident Mercedes expert here, and today we're going to be going through just some of the most pivotal Mercedes designs that we've seen through history, kind of as they've developed the automobile over the last century and change. So, without further ado, we're going to hop right into vehicle design and comfort at the beginning of the 1900s, and maybe even a little bit earlier than that, also with the conception of the automobile. So, starting out our journey here in 1886 was kind of the start of the automobile. So, if you guys are like me and grew up on the Gran Turismo video game series, you'll remember riding effectively a giant tricycle around a host of different racetracks at a top speed of, I don't know, 5 or 6 miles an hour. So, that would have been the first vehicle ever created by Carl Benz. Again, that was 1886, way ahead of anyone else to the punch. It was basically a glorified tricycle, but it was the beginning of the car as we knew it. And then not all that long later, in 1893, we would kind of see that progress into more of what would be kind of thought of as a car today when it added a fourth wheel. This would originally be referred to as the Benz Victoria. So this was, again, four wheels, and kind of as it progressed through the years, these would gain a little bit of horsepower. And keep in mind, this is pretty early, so we're talking 3 horsepower to 4 horsepower, 4 horsepower to 5 horsepower. But they were kind of fine-tuning the design of the automobile year after year, and this is still before the year of 1900. And for that Benz Victoria, there was even a trim level, the vis-a-vis, they called it. It had 2 forward-facing bench seats so that you could be driving the vehicle, you'd have your passenger next to you, then you could even have 2 passengers in front of you facing you so you could have a conversation. So 1886 was the original, the tricycle, and then we kind of saw the actual motor carriage, the motor wagon with 4 wheels, progressing through the years, and all the way through 1900, it would get a little bit more power, get tinkered a little bit, different little trim levels in kind of a coachwork fashion, building these cars to appease the people that they were built for. But in 1901, we started to see kind of the first assertion to say, okay, well, we have the vehicle here, but how can we make it even better? And that's where the honeycomb radiator comes in. So we have the radiator that you and I know today, which is going to have little fins to actually do the cooling of the coolant as it circulates through, airflow coming through. And on this vehicle in 1901, mind you, 1901, this vehicle, the front grille had an integrated honeycomb pattern that would actually have the coolant flowing through it, just like the radiators we know today. I mean, it's pretty much a primitive version of the radiator that you're using in your car, my car today. 1901, it was kind of the first try, first effort, it was the one that stuck, and it's kind of paved the way of automobile cooling as we know it today. So just 5 years later, after pretty much pioneering an effective cooling system, Mercedes got in on something that they weren't technically first to the punch on, but I still feel the need to also note it. This is hybrid technology. So yeah, you heard that right. These vehicles, they would have an electric motor integrated into the wheel hubs that would be driven by a gasoline motor and powered by the gasoline motor. So think of it like a gasoline generator that's feeding power to the electric motors. They're in the hubs of the wheels. Very similar to how we're kind of doing it today, believe it or not. But this is in 1906. The only reason that I'm adding a little bit of an asterisk on this one is technically the loaner Porsche was the first one to the punch on this just a year or two earlier, but it's still worth noting that Mercedes was bringing that to their production cars. I say production because, of course, these are smaller production. There's no big factories just yet, but a hybrid in 1906, that's ridiculous. And then just 4 years later, kind of hopping back into actual gasoline-driven engines, Mercedes made another crazy jump. The multivalve engine. So, I mean, earlier it was almost like tractor format. You'd have these single piston engines. You got the valve in, the valve out, exhaust, so be it. This is when we started to actually see more so in race cars and custom built coaches than pedestrian vehicles, pedestrian being light production, but multivalve engines in 1910. So again, that's going to optimize the efficiency of the vehicle, also greatly increase power, but it's also going to make a power band that's much easier to work with. This first multivalve engine that we did see from Mercedes was actually in the Benz Special Racer. It was race targeted, but it was also a car that you could technically just buy from Mercedes if you had the money and the wherewithal. It had four valves per cylinder, just like the M272 in this car right next to me, or even this one. 1910. So taking pretty big jump forward here to actually 1996. So better part of a century later, and the only reason for that being, we're going to get into some of those more finer details in the time between in a minute, but obviously with other manufacturers coming along, the pace of the automobile started to move very quickly. So the standouts for Mercedes kind of blend in a little bit more. Don't worry, we'll get into them in a minute, but 1996 comes the Vario top. So if any of you know the R170 chassis SLK, it's kind of the inception of the SLK on US format, if you're not going to include some of the earlier small convertible cars, but had this really cool folding hydraulic roof. It would go up and down in only 25 seconds, which at the time was blistering, considering normally you'd have to get out, fold it down yourself, but this thing would, it was awesome. It would pull this origami-like fold, it would break down into pieces, fold into the trunk, tuck away at the push of a button, and then it would pop right back up, all of it hydraulically driven, and the world had never seen anything like it. I mean, I think these days we all have kind of taken for granted the fact that you'll be sitting at a stoplight, someone puts their top up, puts it down, whatever it may be, but that might not exist without the SLK in the 1990s. And it wasn't even a range-topping model. It was one that pretty much anyone could have afforded. It was just a fun little convertible with a ton of awesome tech. Moving forward just a few years to 1999 comes one of my personal favorites because of how ridiculous this one is as well. This is going to be Mercedes Distronic. So this, coming out in 1999, was about as groundbreaking as it gets. Today we just know it as radar cruise control, which is kind of a standard feature in pretty much anything made in the last, I'd say, 5, 6, 7 years. But in 1999, you could get an S-Class or a host of other models even, with a very primitive version of the radar cruise that we know today, complete with braking all the way down to 0 miles an hour, distance control that you could set on the dash. Mercedes was kind of way, way ahead of the punch on it, and people were weary of it, of course, as you would be if you're kind of trusting a car to maintain a distance for you. But it's because of this that we've seen Mercedes kind of perfect this technology through the years, because of the fact that they were so early to the jump on this one. It's why we have it in so many different Mercedes models to this day. Next up, and one of the bigger ones when it comes to anything Mercedes, we're always going to be talking about ride comfort, the plushness of the vehicle. It's so pivotal to the brand, that luxury sort of feeling when you're driving the car, when you're riding in it. So this one's going to be in the suspension department, and it kind of covers three bases. This is going to be air suspension as a whole. I feel you, all you S-Class owners out there that just rolled your eyes because you're tired of dealing with air struts, but it's really important. Additionally, the SLS hydraulic system, and even the ABC or active body control system that so many cars in the early 2000s came under a lot of fire for, but in all honesty, it's a really cool system. So air suspension specifically, as we know it today, we wouldn't have necessarily without the 1963 600 model. That's right, all the way back in 1963, just as we know it today, one of Mercedes' most luxurious models was sporting air suspension with the exact same intention that we have today to maintain that occupancy ride comfort. And then, not all that long afterwards, in the 1970s, we had the 116 model come along, and that started sporting the SLS suspension, or self-leveling suspension. So that's going to use some hydraulic lines routed to the rear suspension, depending on the model and the trim that you may have, the front suspension. It's a way to actually control the amount of fluid circulating around the car, whether you have extra weight in the vehicle, whether you're going over particularly rough terrain and have extra weight on top of that. It's going to give the car the ability to compensate for dynamic side-to-side motion and also to actually keep the vehicle level when needed. Moving forward in the late 1990s and 1999 most pointedly with the 215 chassis, that's the CL class. Again, a car that kind of came under fire a little bit just for being a little too technical for its time, we had the active body control. Anyone who knows Mercedes is probably afraid of this system. It's entirely hydraulically driven. It operates at around 3000 PSI and it's a little bit failure prone, but it's an incredible piece of technology. Just like that SLS suspension, it's using hydraulic fluid to control the way the car behaves over even the tiniest little undulation or bump in the road to deliver the utmost of comfort to the occupants. So why are we kind of touching on all of these little suspension details in one block? Well, because without all of them broken down separately, we wouldn't have the ability to drive the way we do today in some of our more modern Mercedes or even other models. I mean, when you introduce ride height control, when you introduce the way that a shock absorber can be controlled just by distributing hydraulic fluid through the car and air suspension and all of these things, you wouldn't have the Mercedes technology that we see today, a car that can hunker down for higher speeds, or a car that can scan the road ahead of it with the Dampmatic system to see any bumps that may be coming and then compensate in advance. Without these earlier systems through the 60s, the 70s, all the way through the 90s getting fine-tuned, we may not know Mercedes the way we know it today. And last up, when it comes to design and occupancy comfort, is going to be possibly one of the most pivotal areas of the car for any driver or any passenger, which is the seats. That simple. In the early 2000s, in the W220 S-Class, we started to see dynamic and adaptive seats. As ridiculous as that sounds, you're going to see it in some of the highest trim luxury cars today, but you could also see it in just a pedestrian S-Class back in 2000, 2001 with inflating bolsters that would kind of blow up with an air bladder as you went around corners to hold you in tight. They had massaging capability, they had heating and cooling. It was a no-brainer. I mean, now we just expect these things out of a luxury car, but you could just buy them off the showroom floor in 2000, and without Mercedes, we might not have that technology in any car today as a whole. So, design and comfort, it's pretty hard to beat Mercedes as a whole, but when we move over to safety, we see that we really have Mercedes to thank for pretty much the way we operate and the way that we're protected by our cars today. So, as you can see, we really have Mercedes to thank for a lot of what makes the automobile today. And yes, in current times, they can be a little bit tricky with their giant dashboards and screens and cylinder heads that can be a little bit temperamental and things like that, but we really can call them the make of the best or nothing. They provide some of the most influential structure and design to vehicles, from performance to safety, even to ride comfort, that we've ever seen out of any make through history. And for that, we can really only thank Mercedes-Benz and Carl Benz back in the day as a whole. So, if you've learned anything new today, feel free to drop it in the comments or share your favorite tidbit. And of course, as always, feel free to like and subscribe for more information just like this coming your way very soon.